Hello, YouTube.
Hi, YouTube. We have a Heisman Trophy finalist on this very show.
We do. Max Duggan will join us for about 25-minute interview in just a second. Like, subscribe, comment.
Yeah, tell us how funny we are.
Okay, that's not necessary.
It is unnecessary. Big day for us.
Well.
It's a big day.
Big day for all of us. I expected one big-time quarterback in here today. Did not expect two. Now, we've only got one on the show. We got Max Duggan, Heisman Trophy winner, or Heisman Trophy candidate.
Heisman Trophy finalist. And college football playoff quarterback.
Yes, Max Duggan from TCU will be here. We'll interview him in just a second.
He will be on the show. The other one probably would say no to being on the show.
So I was in the Yak today, and we just got through with the Yak, and every time the Yak ends, there's about a two-minute period where we all stay in there and whatever. And Big Cat was talking to his guest out in the lobby, and I was looking at the guest, I was like, because I knew Max Duggan was coming, and I know he's doing PMT in this show. And I was like, is that Max Duggan? Doesn't look like him. He said, no, that's Will Levis. I said, oh, that's Will Levis. And then Will Levis walked into the room and shook everybody's hand and shook my hand. And I didn't think he knew who I was.
No, he.
So I was going to get away scot-free. And then he turned around and said, what does he know anyway? He's a Mississippi State fan. And he, in fact, knew who I was.
He knew who you were, and I will say, normally when people use that insult, like fans use that insult, we say how lame it is. It hits a little bit different.
Yeah, from a player.
And a player that you've had a lot of opinions on.
What do you mean that you knew he you got some inside information?
No, he's from, well, first of all, him and I are social media friends. Second of all.
Are you working behind my back with Will Levis?
No, but second, he's from Connecticut. He grew up in Connecticut when Barstool was blowing up. He's like the face of a prototypical stoolie, like he demographic hits it perfectly, and he's active on social media, so he definitely knows who you are. And he knew, like, if you were walking down the street, he would recognize you before you recognized him.
I agree, because I didn't recognize him, and then they said Will Levis. I was like, oh fuck, and then I shook his hand and he shook my hand and everything was good.
But more importantly, we have Max Duggan on the show.
Max Duggan's on this show. Yeah, yes. Max Duggan, the Heisman candidate and college football playoff participant from TCU. A good interview, too.
It was very funny.
Yeah.
He is very charismatic.
He threw some shots.
He threw a couple jams, yeah. Well, anyway.
Well, you're lucky you didn't talk shit about him all year.
He's funny.
Yeah.
That, I did get lucky. I legitimately never said anything bad about Max Duggan all year.
You never said anything about Duggan.
I said things about TCU, but I never said anything about Duggan, so I got lucky there.
Yeah, we ask him about it. We ask him about a lot of things, so make sure.
Am I a hater?
Yes.
Well, you hate the teams that you think aren't good, which is fine.
Am I just a hater?
No.
You know what?
You're petty.
But Dan.
I've been looking around all day to make sure Stetson Bennett ain't here, too.
Well, he might be. You never know. Dan mentioned this to Roan when we were about to film the Pro Football Football show yesterday. I don't know how it came up, but he was mentioning how you at some point, I think it was after either Toledo or Northern Illinois, you said, I think I need to do a face change. We're like, Brandon, it's far too late for that.
No. You can always turn face.
I don't think so.
That's the things about wrestling. You can never be too bad of a guy. You can always turn good.
You're not a bad guy, but you can't. You've hated so much on so many
you
fan
turned
bases.
Face on Tennessee.
See? And they don't know what to do.
But what would you do if you walked out on a college football show and you didn't get booed?
Well, I don't get booed at every show.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't. I do not get booed at every show. That's fake news. I don't get booed at every show. I get booed.
You don't get booed the way that you
I especially
did there.
Don't get booed coming out.
Definitely not. I might get booed coming out.
I might get booed like during the show at some point, but yeah. I might lean into it. But I
think
don't
the only time you've been booed coming out is
you know
Iowa.
Where I didn't get booed this year? Tennessee. I sucked that dick hard.
Okay.
Gave him some Rocky Top.
All right.
Jack can handle it.
Okay.
No.
Let's just start the show. After
Rocky
that,
Top was funny.
Yeah, let's.
No,
oh, it was
I
very
it was
funny.
Funny.
I just,
it was just the. I sucked that dick.
There's a lot of emphasis on it, so we should just start the show. And if I could have a high noon right now, I would drink one to try to forget that.
Let's do the show. Hello, and welcome to Unnecessary Roughness, Barstool's College Football Podcast. Forgot what kind of show this was.
It's a podcast.
I forget at least one word every intro. So that time the word was podcast. Sometimes it's roughness, sometimes it's football. Who knows? It is Barstool's College Football Podcast brought to you by High Noon Hard Seltzer. Never forget those words.
Never forget High Noon. You've got the tailgate pack in front of you, per usual. I will say credit to Katie for getting this tailgate pack to us every single day, because I think it might be the only one in the office because the tailgate packs are
so
popular.
It's seen some things. It's hanging by its last.
Yeah, this thing is. This thing's been through the wars with us this year.
Because everybody wants to have the pear and the cranberry, the two newest flavors, also the black cherry and the grapefruit. And I will say, I know we're waiting. High Noon. drop the new flavors.
Oh, they're coming. Don't worry. Fine Noon always keeps probably it fresh.
2023.
Which I would love, because that means I'm going to be able to drink them. But the tailgate pack, and I love that it was branded the tailgate pack, because obviously it's football and, you know, we all tailgate. But it's also very seasonal, because pear and cranberry also like low-key winter flavors.
Pear, really?
I think so.
Pear seems more summery to me.
I think pear is a versatile fruit. But like, if you
I would say that. I'd say
you,
so, yeah.
You know, like when you have charcuterie boards, you usually have pears or apples on them.
Well, you must be doing some high-end charcuterie.
I love charcuteries. But so a pear would fit. I think pear is kind of Christmassy. But like I've been saying for a long time, cranberry, you can just add some fresh cranberries into this baby or just drink it right out of the can. It's very, very festive.
We should do a charcuterie board on this show one day.
What, you're going to create one?
Maybe.
Pair with the pear.
Just have charcuterie out here.
You know, if you take some candy and wrap it and you put it there, it's not going to count.
I love high-end meats.
And we
that
love
is my answer to that statement. I love high-end meats.
High-end
cheese.
High-end High Noons. Look at that.
This is a high-end drink right here. High Noon, hard seltzer. Try it out.
You know what else is high-end? Our interview with Max Duggan that you're going to lead into right now.
Good Lord. I just ate three jokes right there about high-ends. That's okay. It doesn't matter. We did have Max Duggan, TCU's quarterback, 12-0 this regular season, going to the college football playoff to play Michigan, and in New York City right now for the Heisman Trophy ceremony this Saturday night. Here's the interview right now. It is our interview with Max Duggan. All right, so it is Heisman Trophy season.
It is.
Which means we have Heisman Trophy candidates in New York City as they get ready to go to the downtown athletic club on Saturday night.
No, it's not there anymore.
As they get ready to go to formerly the Downtown Athletic Center, now called the Lincoln Center.
Well, Downtown Athletic Club. I live next to Downtown Athletic Club, but
you think this is that big of a deal?
It's in Lincoln Center now.
It's in Lincoln Center.
59th Street, Columbus Circle.
Heisman Trophy candidates are in New York City for the Heisman Trophy ceremony this Saturday night at Lincoln Center around Columbus Circle. Isn't that thrilling?
On 59th.
Thank you very much. Yes. Don't touch me. To my right is not only a Heisman Trophy candidate, but also a quarterback who's going to be playing in the college football playoff. Mm-hmm. He is the quarterback of an undefeated regular season team, 12-0 this year. Perfect regular season for this guy. It is Max Duggan from TCU. Hello.
What's up? How are you guys doing?
Doing great. Doing good. Doing good. And
happy
we had
to have you.
We had to make sure when you came in, I did not talk very much shit about you this season.
Very much or any?
Any. I never talked any shit about him on an individual basis.
I know. I was giving you credit.
I maybe said
it's a rare thing for him to not talk any shit.
Do you keep track of who says bad stuff about you?
No.
Yeah, you do.
You really don't?
You know who talks shit on you, but you don't keep track of it.
Well, then that's two different ideals you just said.
You know who does it. You don't keep track. You don't go out and
look. Oh, you don't worry about it. Okay, I see.
But you do keep mental tabs.
You know the people that –
Yeah, we get it way less than you. We still get it, and we all know who does it. We just always talk shit.
I think
back.
Some athletes keep like tweets and
stuff
motivation.
In their phone. Kevin Durant does it. He has burners.
Baker Mayfield.
Do you have a burner?
Yeah.
No burners?
No, I don't.
Are you on Twitter at all?
I have a Twitter. I think it's the best app. I never tweet, though. I'm boring.
Okay.
I don't do anything fun.
Question. No does way. TCU need a manlier gesture? I've been thinking about this all year.
What's
if you guys,
States?
Hold on. First of all,
that's a great question.
First of all, relax.
Great question. They ring bells.
You're in the playoff. Yeah. This is manly.
They ring really dainty little bells.
They're not dainty. They're big and sturdy.
And
but you guys, you know, when you score a touchdown, you do something great, and the fans go, hey.
You gotta bend them a little bit more.
A little more?
Yeah.
That's
like USC, like right. SMU, TCU. Mm.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, like USC.
I know
SMU.
That's fight on.
Yeah, so SMU is like right here. TCU, you gotta like
all the way.
Up.
It's a lot more.
He didn't tell me that. He hasn't told me that all year. Okay, so this.
Yeah, there you go, right there. There you go.
It has
knuckle
to be
up. Yeah,
very,
that's.
Very, yes.
Okay, well, that is manlier than like this.
Yeah, that's
this
SMU.
This is kind of like sad bunny ears.
But wait,
like,
SMU's a Mustang.
They're like pony up or something like that.
Pony up.
Yeah. I think pony
that's
up.
Weird.
You gotta really be.
Do we
jagged
call this anything?
It.
Frogs up, horns up.
I don't. Horns up, maybe. I don't know. There's not really
frogs
a name.
Up. Frogs up.
Yeah.
It's not that much different from this.
No, I do like a good hand gesture.
Yeah,
I do. I just want to make sure. Okay, so.
But this one's good because you can't reverse it. Horns down, you go like this.
Yeah.
But like,
yeah,
what are you supposed to do? Like this?
Yeah.
Like
this? That doesn't.
People would be like, what?
No, people have tried it. It's just not the same.
Yeah,
you can't
it doesn't
do anything
work
to that.
Yeah, there's
okay.
only one school that just uses their entire hand signal and motto against
well, you know
TCU,
where she
and that's
it holds everybody hostage with their.
Well, aren't you like from or like? close to Fort Worth, right?
I'm from Arlington, yeah. Oh, went to Nolan Catholic in Fort Worth. I had a lot of friends who went to TCU. I hated all
TCU.
Of them.
She hates
TCU. No, no.
Just all the kids that you went to high school with?
They all...
They were better than her.
They all... Well, no. They all became just gigantic douchebags. But I've been out of high school for a long time, so it's probably way different now that you're there. Dawson's not a douchebag.
We claim Dawson heavily, so he is a great
Yeah, he's great.
We claim him.
I've told Dawson this over the last year, that it's been much easier to like TCU as the school now that all of my friends are so old and we're out of college, because when they were in college, when we were in college, it was very hard.
When it comes to the students and the fans in this office, Dawson is definitely one of the least douchey.
Yes.
Because the Alabama guy we got here is a jerk.
He has some moments.
The Tennessee guy is the worst.
He took credit for the kickers. Yeah, so
Dawson took credit for
this is an unreal story.
Wait, the kicker that ran on the field the last second?
He said, hold on. This is before the kick. He said, before that drive that Max led down the field, he said he went up to the kicker. He's like, this is what we dream of. Like, go get him, man. And then that was what? He made the kick.
Why does no one believe it?
No,
is it true?
You think that happened?
Yeah, I think. Yeah. Yes, it happened.
You think this guy walked up to the kicker and said, this is what we dream of?
Should we call Griffin right now?
No. We should not call Griffin right now. No. We're not going to bother Griffin. Did you at any point during that game, and we're talking about the game where you guys beat Baylor, right?
Yeah.
Did you at any point think, oh, there's not enough time for this to happen? I'm panicking a little bit.
You never really panic. I know you guys aren't going to believe that, but there's times where all right, we got to roll, whatever, it's 8 minutes, you're down two possession, one possession, it's all right, we got to score, we got to get points, we got to make sure, because if we don't right here, it's probably going to get a little tight, but you never panic where you're in
after the 2-point conversion that you didn't get, was there a moment that you're like, man,
that one
that
you're
may
like
be it?
That one you're like, okay, maybe, I just screwed that up.
Yeah.
You knew, all right, you get off the sideline, hey, we still got 3 timeouts left. We're going to get the ball back. Yep. So.
And on top of that, all season, you guys kept having the TCU magic. So at that point, you were probably like, this is just, I'm confident. The team is confident.
Now, hold on.
You weren't confident.
I want to ask a question.
He wasn't confident.
Do you think it's TCU magic, or you were telling me in the elevator it's Max Duggan magic? Is that what you were saying?
No, it's TCU magic.
Okay, all right.
Just move the mic up a little bit.
Yeah.
You talking to me or him?
Him. He knows how to do it.
The highs?
Yeah, that's good.
He's got it. We got it. Question.
See, he's already trying to throw you under the bus.
No, I'm not.
That's all right.
Yes, he is.
No, I'm not. I'm not trying to do that at all. The Heisman Trophy ceremony this Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have both of your reactions ready?
I guess I don't really know.
Have you practiced your reactions?
Nope.
You haven't practiced your winning reaction?
Nope. Just going to kind of see what happens. It's going to be an honest reaction.
If you have to give a speech, are you just going to go off the cuff?
No, you'll prepare stuff. I think everybody prepares. Even if you don't think you're going to win, you're just, you got to prepare something.
Right, exactly.
So, yeah, you'll have something.
How much money on my wallet to get you to just walk out if they announce somebody else is the winner?
Yeah, no.
No,
also there's not enough in there. I can guarantee you that.
I got $60 in my wallet right now. So, been carrying around a little bit of kind of.
Have you talked to Caleb yet since his – I know his tweet wasn't about you, but that was – when you saw the tweet, what was your reaction to it?
I saw it and I didn't think anything negative of
it. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I understood what he was saying.
Me too.
Where he was like the double standards.
Exactly.
Of I was getting kind of shit talked when I was doing it, and he wasn't doing it towards me.
Yeah, I know.
That's how it got taken, out of context, a bunch of guys were going at him. I didn't take it that way.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because he seems like, at first my reaction was like, wait, what's he saying about Max? But then I was like, wait, I get it, because people were making fun of him.
That's how I took it out.
Yeah.
Do you guys have a group text yet?
No, we don't. I haven't met these guys before. I guess, Caleb, after we played him last year at OU, I haven't met CJ or Stetson, though.
Okay.
I think they're getting in tomorrow.
Yeah, you guys should. I know you'll have some activities.
Yeah, we'll get to know each other. Spend some time together.
Don't tell Stetson that me and you have met either, because I've pissed off
Stetson. Hates him.
Stetson hates me, too. So
tried to dunk all over him on Twitter this
week, too. Yeah, it's fine. This is a real TCU question. This isn't a Heisman Trophy question. TCU, 12-0. Now you're going to be playing in the playoff. When did you realize this season could be really special? And please do not say the first day of fall camp. Give me a real answer here. When did you know that, this season could be special?
I think when we played Oklahoma State at home, we were 5-0. They were 5-0, I think. So it's kind of early on. They were eighth in the country, and you go to that double overtime.
Huge comeback.
Come back. We were able to win. You're like, okay, that's a big momentum swing. We get Kansas State at home. We're down big, that's a huge game, and you come back and win. So that kind of Kansas was in there on the road game day. So that kind of three game kind of like schedule was when you're like, okay, you know, we have a shot. We knew that, you know, we had some back end games with at Texas and at Baylor that were going to be difficult to go win. You know, that we were going two back to back.
You guys
games.
Had a crazy schedule.
Yeah,
because you. Your bye was what, like week
three,
which
yeah,
especially and with the Big 12 this year, there was no easy game.
So this
no,
is your so, first week off in
yeah,
2 months.
Yeah, we went through the whole Big 12 without a bye week, which like no one really realizes like how big that is. Like it sucks when you
physically
don't get
a bye. Speaking,
yeah.
I'm sure it's just
and you
like,
don't like you're like mentally too like just getting like grinded down. It like it's not fun.
I know you said that you guys don't necessarily pay as much attention as obviously we do because we do this for a living. But when you talk about you were 5-0, then 6-0. Everybody in the country was slowly having to be like, okay, TCU is the real deal. TCU could do this and go undefeated. Well, no, credit to you for admitting that much later than you actually did. How much of that did you guys pay attention to? Did you hear any of that? Just if ever like, well, they're going to lose eventually. They're not going to be undefeated going to the Big 12 championship.
I think like the good thing about our team, so like coming in, we were picked whatever dead last in the Big 12. Like everyone told us how bad we were going to be and like, hey, you guys are going to be horrible first year head coach. Like you're not bringing back all that. And it was like, okay, you don't want to listen to when they're talking bad about you. So when you get up and you're undefeated, it's like, all right, now everyone wants to kind of tell you how good you are and get on your back. It's like, hey, you can't really like listen to them at that point. I think Dykes does a good job of like, hey, like cut the noise out. Don't listen. It's like cliche to say. I think every college football team says that. Like, hey, don't listen to the outside noise, like all that. But I think that's what we did. It was like, hey, they don't listen to them when they tell us we're so bad. Don't listen to them now that we're good.
Did you ever feel bad for the quarterbacks of the other team who kept getting hurt?
Brandon Walker.
I knew you were going to bring it up.
Katie wrote these questions for me.
Don't blame.
I didn't write them down.
No, this is definitely his handwriting, Max. Do not let him lie to you again.
No, I'm just. Did you ever feel bad?
Everybody deals with injuries.
That's true.
Facts.
Yeah. That's true.
Like everyone was like, oh, you know, it's their guys are getting hurt. It's like we were missing starters.
Yeah.
So.
Well, you weren't there, Jack.
No, I was there. I was from game one.
Oh, that's true. This guy over here was TCU from the jump.
Yeah, that's what. Yeah, no.
He said they're going to be good from the start.
And finally, thank you.
Good Lord.
There you go.
Well, Dawson at one point gave me a helmet, but it was fake. It was a fake present. He came on the show and was like, here's the helmet from the team. And then he was like, I need it back after the show. It was the fakest present I've ever gotten in my life. It was almost like Santa showed up and was like, here. But I need it back, like, on the 26th.
So this guy believed in you, so you brought him a gift.
Yes.
There's a hoodie.
You didn't believe in his team.
You shouldn't
ever
get shit.
I know, but I got to start. I got.
You were not a Frog fan this year.
No.
Well, first of all.
He was not.
Not relax. I love Frogs. Secondly, all I got to do to start getting hoodies from is just believe in team. I'm going to believe in everybody next year.
Well, you won't.
I'm going to believe in everybody.
You won't, but you also got to make sure that you play it right where their quarterback's going to be a Heisman Trophy candidate.
Yeah, Jack got lucky
playoff
here.
Yeah.
Jack bet on the right horse.
Yeah, he bet on the right horse because you get the double whammy with both a Heisman candidate and somebody that's going to be in the playoff. So that hoodie means a lot more than you would ever get.
You said you have a Twitter, but you don't really pay attention to it.
I'm on Twitter. I read all that.
Do you have a TikTok?
I do have a TikTok, but I don't post anything. If you like found my account,
there was a TikTok recently.
went a little bit viral.
A little bit viral. It's interesting, and it's Max Duggan. Well, it's basically a lick talk, where you lick your hands a lot, and the ladies
were
going crazy.
Why do you dry it after?
It's like a nervous tick.
Oh, okay.
It's like, you know, when guys like, you know, before a golf swing, it's
thumb,
like,
finger,
you know,
dry?
Yeah, like the two fingers and then my thumb, and then. It's like a nervous, like golf swings, like things that's right. You know, guys are just kind of weird.
Yeah,
that's like me. It's just like a routine before every play now. And now it's like I do it too much where it's like being weird.
And you don't even think about it.
I don't even think about
it. When did it start?
Oh, like probably when I was in high school.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. No, people are definitely taking notice.
Oh, yeah. People text me all the time about like, that's nasty. Like, stop licking your fingers.
Oh, I don't think the girls at TCU seem to think it's very nasty.
No, the TikTok of them like falling over.
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
that was a good TikTok from the girls, and then having you involved in doing
it
was.
Our people showed me the video, and that was the first time I saw it. I was like, oh, no.
There was my biggest question for you is obviously right now, I'm sure you're seeing all these quarterbacks in the transfer portal. You probably had more than enough opportunities to consider that, but you stayed. Was there ever a point you thought you would be leaving TCU? Obviously, you came in. You were not really the backup to start the season, but Chandler started the first game, and then you came in, what, the second quarter, third quarter?
Mm.
Was there ever a time you were like, maybe I should look somewhere else?
I really didn't, and not a lot of people believe, like, I really didn't.
Yeah.
I wanted to I'm graduating in December, so I had a semester left in school. I wanted to finish, you know, school at TCU, and I knew that we, you know, with Dykes coming in, we had a shot, you know, to kind of change something, and I wanted to be there whether I was playing or not.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I like, my best friends were on the team. Like, I've been with those guys. It's like, all right, you know, I want to be here on this with, like, this season, see if we can have a shot to, you know, have a special season, because we've been so bad the last 3 years. You're like, okay, like, you know, I want to be at TCU when we're winning.
Yeah, right?
Something like that. So, it really, I never wanted to transfer.
And how much of Coach Dykes, like, played into that? Because obviously when you talk about Coach of the Year, he's got to be high up there. I mean, the first season with him, how much of that kept you there with the relationship you have with him?
Yeah, it was fantastic. You know, he cares so much about, like, our guys and, you know, the people in the program. And you think about, you know, if you get a shot to play, you look at what he's been able to do with offenses, you know, what Garrett Riley's been able to do with quarterbacks, like, all the things, you know, he's been so successful.
Yeah.
And it's like, if you get a shot and to play, like, it's going to be, you know, you're going to have a, you know, good opportunity.
So how many of how far were you into the season when you realized that sometimes I can just throw it up and Quentin Johnson's going to go get it?
Oh, I learned that, like, my sophomore year.
That guy is incredible.
Yeah. I just close my eyes and, yeah, like, throw it back, yeah, and he kind
of. That guy's one of the best receivers in the country. Now, you got a lot of talented players around you, and obviously you're a very talented player too, but sometimes I just watch Quentin Johnson play, and I'm like, oh, my God.
Oh, yeah, no, you can, yeah, close your eyes and punt it to him, and it's like, that probably should have gotten picked.
Yeah.
But Q just makes a one, like, heck of a catch, and you're like, okay, I'm good. Good thing he's on our team.
Yeah.
Now, I want to take you back. Now, you're playing in the playoff, so we're going to look forward in a second, but the Big 12 championship game. You end up coming up short at the end in overtime, but that drive, you're down 8 points, and you rush for 95 yards in like 4 or 5 plays, something like that. You were out of breath at the end. Are you out of shape?
I was broke. Okay. I'm not.
No, I knew. I saw it. Yeah, even on the sidelines, you're like,
you were down bad.
Yeah, no, I'm not. I'm not out of shape. Our strength guys get us going, yeah, and all that. So, like, I'm not out of shape, but it was like, I need to, like, take a break. Like, I could not have done, like, anything. If they said to run, like, 20 more yards, it would have been like, no, I'm down.
Well, on the 2-point conversion, I was like, y'all got to take a timeout and let him breathe. But they couldn't use the timeout because they needed it. So I was like,
That's what I was hoping. We were calling a pass. Yeah. If there was going to be a run play, I'd be like, oh, boy.
Did,
like,
you realize how tired you were in the middle of the drive, or did it take you afterwards with the adrenaline to kind of wear down and be like, holy shit, I just ran a lot?
After, so right before we scored, it was after the long run when it was like, I'm so broke right now. Like,
yeah.
And then you look to the sideline, you get the play, and it's like, all right, it's a QB run. You're like,
fuck.
Damn.
Yeah, yep. Right. Yep. No, the long run, I think, was like 50 yards, 45 yards or something like that, and you ran down the field. And when you went out of bounds, I don't think I ever saw a quarterback as happy to see a sideline as you when you were like, oh, fuck, I got to get out of here.
Yeah, no, it was trying to make a play.
Yeah.
Trying to make a play.
All right, now, this is an individual weekend for you. It's a team thing. If your team wasn't great this year, you know that. But now, after this Heisman Trophy ceremony is over, you go back to Texas and get ready for the Michigan Wolverines. Tell me where you are in that process right now.
Yeah, so we're going to start practicing on Sunday. So after this weekend, you know, I'm going back for practice, and we get into bowl prep. And, yeah, it's going to be difficult. You know, whatever, they're 27-1 or something, whatever their record is the last 2 years. And it's like, they're playing so well right now. You know, they're so good offensively where you're not going to have a lot of opportunities for us to get the ball, because they run the ball so well, they throw the ball. Defensively, they're athletic, they're tough, they're physical, they're huge out there. Like, they're the best, you know, one of the best teams in the country. So we better make sure that we have a good game plan going in, you know, whatever, good 3 weeks to prepare for them. So it's gonna be a good one, though.
When they have the College Football Playoff Committee unveiling of the rankings, they always have, you know, reporters there in your rooms and all across the country waiting. Did you have a feeling, and I know you guys felt like you were going to be in the College Football Playoff, should have been, and obviously you are. Did you have a preference whether you were going to be playing Georgia or Michigan?
I think either way, it was like, you're going to be on a tough matchup.
Yeah.
So it was like,
were you nervous that you guys weren't going to, that your name wasn't going to show up?
So after the game, obviously we get beat. You're like, okay, now it's kind of out of our hands. Mm-hmm. We knew if we won, we were going to be in.
Yeah.
You know, but once we get beat, you're like, okay. And then when they're announcing it, we're all watching it, and they kind of took a lot of time between three.
Yeah.
And you're like, holy, like, are we going to get jumped? Are we going to get bounced? And it's like, oh no. So
they were drawing that out because if everybody knew who 1 and 2 was going to be, it was the debate of if Ohio State jumped you guys or not. So we were all sitting there like, all right, keep it going.
And
I can't
Alabama.
Imagine being, and I couldn't imagine being in the room with that. But I didn't know if, like, secretly you were like, I'd rather play one of these teams.
No, honestly, it's like, either way, you're going to – whoever you're going to play in the playoff, it's like, all right, it's going to be one, like, heck of a matchup. Like, you're going to have to play your best to beat them. So
you're going to have to play the best team eventually.
Yeah.
Either way.
So this Saturday night, Heisman Trophy ceremony, at what point in the season did you realize this could be in your future?
I don't really know. Maybe kind of towards the end of the year. I don't know.
Dawson's over in the corner.
Should we just interview Dawson? Dawson, you want to be on the show?
I don't know.
No, it's Dawson.
Dawson's always got my back. Okay. I always know I got someone in my corner.
No, he does.
Always. And I will tell you, every single Monday after you guys would win again, he would take a slow walk through the office and make sure he made great eye contact with Brandon.
I remember in August, I was here. I was getting ready for the season, and he would always come up to me, and he would say, Brandon, TCU's got this quarterback, and he's going to be great this year. Could be a Heisman contender. His name is Chandler Morris. Yeah. And I was like, really? Are you sure? And then he ended up changing his mind later. But that's what he was like in August. I just need you to know that.
Biggest TCU fan right there.
Oh, by far.
It's almost – it's absurd, really. He's probably the – he might be the biggest fan of any team that I know. Like I don't know that I know a bigger fan.
Somebody in the office like that, right?
Well, we got a lot of people that are stupid about their teams.
Yeah, but you need an underdog, though, like a TCU. Everyone wants to be on the big brands, you know, the cool teams.
Well,
come
she's
on
Texas A&M. They went 4-8 this year.
Well, no, they won 5 games.
Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me.
They did. Yeah.
Do you want to ring a cowbell, by the way?
No, I don't.
Don't do it.
Why was that no so emphatic?
Because the College World Series, it's like going to that and having Mississippi State be there and their whole fan base has cowbells.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Ruins the game.
It's awesome.
Thank you. Yeah.
That's awesome.
It's true. See, he won't admit it. And I assume that you've never been to a football game.
No,
in Mississippi
it's a
State.
Cool tradition. I think it's cool, but like to be a fan on an opposing team or not a fan of Mississippi State, it's not fun to watch a game. You gotta bend him more.
What was that? That was like a wildcat, like our cat.
You know that Giggum is about TCU.
Is it really? Oh yeah, that makes sense.
That's why I was saying.
Wait, do you know that their male cheerleaders or whatever?
Yell leaders.
They like grab their balls.
No, okay. This is not. About
do you know about
each other? I've seen the videos that went viral. Whatever this year.
Yeah.
This is
like,
not about
the midnight yell or something.
Oh no. So like during
during the games. Oh, I don't know about this.
They're lying to you.
They'll grab their balls to feel the pain that the team's going through. So it's like similar. It's
Max
like
is
a,
not true.
No, it is. We can show you evidence.
The only reason I brought it up is because Giggum was about TCU because you gig horned frogs. That's how you kill them.
Why would you ever need to kill a horned frog?
Well, if you're playing him in football.
Yeah, but then nobody's going to gig him in a game. That would be crazy.
Well, how do you hook him?
Also, who's behind these videos on your TCU? Like, is that guy high all
the
time?
Oh, the hypnotoad
thing? No, like those videos, the wind videos.
The montage, like.
Yeah, they're insane.
Our guys are pretty creative.
Yeah, they
are. Our guys are pretty good. They're some fun guys to be around, and girls. We have a good little group that, you know, they do a good job.
So you grew up in Iowa, and I know we have to let you go because you have a show to do, like Pardon My Take.
Oh,
everybody
wants to do Pardon My Take.
Everyone. But did you, whenever you were growing up, did you have a specific team that you knew you wanted to play for?
I grew up a Notre Dame fan.
Okay.
I grew up a Notre Dame fan as like a little kid, but once you start getting recruited, it kind of goes out. Yeah. I know some people are like, you know, I grew up a whatever fan and I want to play for that school. When I was getting recruited, it was less like that. Like, hey, you know, I went on a visit, things of that sort, but I didn't really, you know, care for like, that's my team.
Council Bluffs, Iowa is interesting. It's like 2 or 3 hours from every school, right? Like, it's not close to anything.
Lincoln's 45 minutes.
Is it 45 minutes? Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I'm very stupid. Excuse me. I know Iowa State and Iowa are like 2.5, 3
hours
away.
Yeah, those are all
so,
middle
so
state.
You're really more, like I said, you're more in Nebraska than you are Iowa, really.
Yeah, like we're closer to University of Nebraska than Iowa State and Iowa.
Omaha's right across the river.
Creighton, basketball?
No, we don't.
I ate at the Cracker Barrel in Council Bluffs many times when I was up there.
Oh, yeah? Did you go to the Horseshoe or anything like that?
That's where – we stayed at our casino. We have a casino.
The Ameristar.
The Ameristar.
Oh, yeah.
It looks like the boat from Ozark.
Yeah.
I don't know if you watched that show, but
that's
exactly what it looks like.
Does it?
Just like it.
I've never watched Ozark.
It's
that's
fantastic.
A good show.
What's your favorite TV show?
Watching his own
Game
highlights.
Game of Thrones?
Really?
That's a good one.
Okay.
Well, I say it's football season.
Do you ever watch your own highlights or no? Like, you ever type in, like...
I feel like it's kind of weird, right?
It would be weird,
no, it is weird, but that doesn't mean you
I mean,
do
like,
I would
Dak Prescott's phone, his screensaver is a photo of himself. Like,
well, you had to call him out.
No, well, it was like an example.
Okay.
I don't know. Do you guys, like, go home and watch this, you know, show?
I do.
Really?
All the time.
He loves himself.
I do not. I am terrific. I do film study on myself. Like,
yeah,
there we go.
Yeah, like right now I'm twisting this pen too much. I'll have to get rid of that. I'll have to fix that. You know, you just gotta find what you do on film and fix it.
We're getting better. That's
we have meetings around here.
I love it.
Yes,
film
tweeted a video of you drinking a beer with I think that's your girlfriend.
Oh, yeah.
And it got 15,000 likes. I don't know if you saw that.
Yeah.
Just you drinking a Coors Light, which is awesome. You're also referred to as 30-pack Max or 30-rack Max.
All right, what is that?
It's like a rack of beer.
Oh, 30-rack.
Not that old.
I thought rack was money.
No.
Well, there is.
You could say like big rack, boobs.
Why are you pointing my titties when you said that?
There's different meanings for rack.
30-rack Max. How'd you earn that name?
You know, you go out.
You drink like a lot of beer. You drink a lot of beer.
It's in season, Brandon.
Yeah.
It's in season.
This weekend.
You mean it's the football season. I thought you meant beer was in season. No. What? It's not like oysters.
There is like, you mentioned that you guys start practice for Michigan on Sunday, but you're also in New York City for the Heisman trophy ceremony.
Yeah, if you win the Heisman.
So it's like, how do you?
Yeah, well, I'll be back by Sunday. We're practicing Sunday night.
But you won't have a lot of beers on Saturday night or?
Yeah, you got to start prepping.
I mean, this is 30-rack match.
Yeah, you got to start prepping.
I mean, if you win the high, you have to go out in New York City. Even if you...
Well, not if you have a national championship to win.
That is true.
See, that's the thing is a lot of these guys are probably, you know...
Johnny won it, all he had to do was play in the...
Another shot. See
against Duke, right?
This isn't about me. This is about Max. We'll let you go, I promise. What's the best part about playing for TCU?
What's the best part about playing for TCU?
That's a good question.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I'll tell you this, and you guys aren't going to agree with it, but I'm telling you, I think we have one of the best student sections in the country. As we have 10,000 kids undergrad, okay? We had more than 50% of our students at all of our home games this year. And I know you guys are going to be like, oh, like that's not numbers, anything like that. Like,
why do you think we're going to doubt you so much?
SEC,
relax, man. We believe you.
But no, I will say, though, because he has a point. It's like when you look at the biggest student sections in the country, it's always like there's 30, 40,000 kids there. But the student population is 50, 60, 70.
Yeah. Yeah.
You guys are a small private school in Fort Worth. I've been to plenty of games, and it is a very cool student section.
Think,
it just doesn't get the love.
I think they have a good time. They get after it. I know guys that have played against us, and they're like, obviously they're right behind their sideline, so I think that's one of the best parts.
I like that.
RG3 played at TCU a few times, but the loudest place he ever said he played at was UConn Rensselaer Field, the Rent.
Really?
Yeah.
He did say that, but he's lying.
Don't you wish you would just rung the damn cowbell now, so you wouldn't have to hear about UConn? All you had to do was ring the cowbell.
Where's the loudest place you've ever played?
Great question again.
Yeah.
And that'll be the last question.
Okay. Stillwater gets pretty loud.
Mm-hmm.
OU gets pretty loud.
You can't just say every place, man.
I'm just saying those are probably the two loudest, like Oklahoma State and Oklahoma.
Was playing at Colorado pretty cool?
Yeah, like Colorado was – their student section was awesome. Like, that was the first game of the year.
What about that last drive against Baylor? Were they not going crazy?
They were, but it wasn't like –
You don't respect Baylor as much.
Oklahoma State's got the paddles. Like, those things are annoying.
When you were in the final question, we've done eight final questions, but that play against Baylor, did you look up the clock and be like, holy shit, is there not enough time? Like,
no,
obviously you didn't call it, but, like, you ran off the field.
Well, you have to have at least – it's like 15 to 18
You did
seconds.
Not ask that. We'll talk
I
about it later.
I very much asked
no,
that.
You let
asked,
him answer, and then we'll argue when he leaves.
No, you need like 15 to 18 seconds to get that play off. And I think
You had 19 seconds.
There you go. So that's enough time.
Okay.
So,
and he nailed it. Thanks to Dawson.
Yes, that's right.
Thanks to Dawson.
All right. Saturday night Heisman Trophy ceremony. This guy, Caleb Williams, CJ Stroud, Stetson Bennett somehow. No, relax. Just – no, it's fine. It's fine. Good luck.
Appreciate
and
it.
Not only in the Heisman Trophy ceremony, and also in the college football playoff as you guys go against Michigan. Max Duggan, TCU quarterback. So that was Max Duggan. Good guy.
Yeah, great guy. We only had a sparse amount of time. Is that the word that I'm looking for?
It was more than sparse. It was like 25 minutes.
He gave us a lot.
He gave us a lot. I felt like we could have talked to him for like a three-hour
episode.
We had
a finite amount of time.
Finite. That's the word. Yes. No, it was great. I love that. You know, whether it was Dawson that preempted him with all the background information or if he just knows Barcel that well, when he came in to meet us, he knew who everybody was. He knew our backgrounds. That's always very impressive. I mean, the kid is very funny.
Yeah, he's an impressive guy, and he's going for the Heisman this week. We'll see what happens.
And he was very chill.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, he was like, not to pump his tires too much, but he came in here, sat down, and was just – it was almost like he was on the podcast with us for – months.
We're just shocked that he was a human being.
Also, and like, they go through so much media training, so I feel like almost every player has been brainwashed. Like, this is the answer. This is the form. You have to hit it.
Right.
And I feel he's able to kind of, like, be like, oh, this is not that place. I can actually be myself.
Yeah, if they're Barstool fans, they know that they get to let loose in here a little bit, which was fun. So, Brandon.
Yes. Hi.
I hope that everybody enjoyed the interview. I also hope that everyone enjoys your majestic beard that you've been rocking.
Isn't it something?
It is majestic. But you know what's most important about beards?
You about to knock it off right now?
Well, no. What's most important about a beard is that you keep it high and tight, right? You keep it clean. You don't need a long neck beard. And our friends at Bic, they are keeping your beard and people who shave completely, people who shave any part of their body, they're keeping them clean this
Let me tell
holiday
you,
season.
The worst part about shaving when it gets this thick, when it's an actual beard, I dread shaving the beard off, and I shave it off once every month or two, probably. And it's coming soon that I'm going to have to do it. So the most frustrating part is when I start shaving and the razor gets clogged and just shuts down everything. And then even when you wash it out, it's still not going to unclog entirely. These razors just, once they get clogged, it's hard to get back to the true nature of the razor. Not with the Bic Easy Rinse razor. They've got patented anti-clogging technology for a smoother shave and less irritation. It is exactly what you need for shaving.
Well, and the best thing about this specific Bic razor is that it's made for any part of the body, for men and women. And I know we've talked about this, Katie, when we've talked about Bic before. When you shave your legs with an old or clogged razor, not only does it take forever, it takes so much longer, it hurts because it's just like dragging that skin.
You're gonna nick yourself more often. Like, no matter how many times you kind of hit the razor, there's just always hair in it, and it just, you can never get it out.
Never get it out. But with Bic, they figured out the perfect. I know it's gross.
I would hate to shave my legs.
It does.
Think of the surface area too.
Yeah, it's long. It's a long, long process. But
yeah, what are you like 6'8"?
I'm not close enough.
I don't know.
Are you closer to 6'8" than 5'8"?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. No, right in the middle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right in the middle. She's 6'2".
Yeah, literally
right?
In the middle. Yeah.
Right
in the middle. I think I'm shrinking, but yeah.
But they. The Bic razors will help her 6'8" long legs. Help my 6 feet legs, your 7 feet legs, whatever you want
to
shave.
So you're
shave
just adding them. Inches to everybody.
You're welcome.
Would you rather me take them away? Anyways, you can buy the Bic Easy Rinse right now at Amazon or Walmart.com. And starting in January, they can be found in retail stores nationwide. But the biggest thing, we're giving away free money again.
Yes, we are.
20% off of Bic Easy Rinse on Amazon.com. If you use the code 20EASYRINSE, that's 20EASYRINSE, start living life less clogged. Life is always better less clogged. So is your shave. Use 20EASYRINSE for 20% off Bic Easy Rinse at Amazon.com today. Great stocking stuffers, by the way. Everybody
great
needs
stocking
a razor.
Stuffer. Yes.
Everybody needs a razor.
Yes. All right. We're going to go through some news, and then I have got one topic for us that I came up with today, and it's called 7 Up, 7 Down.
Oh, sounds we've done
yeah,
this,
we've
I
done
think,
this before.
Right?
Probably. I don't know. Who knows?
Because I think we talked about how like 7 Up is just not a thing up here.
Maybe. But we're going to do 7 Up, 7 Down. 7 teams that came out of the season going that way.
Sprite.
And, well, no. 7 Up and Sprite. Okay. 7 teams that came out of the season going up, and 7 that came out of the season going down.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And I have 2 be careful teams. Be careful because you might start going downhill faster than you think.
Ooh.
But we.
What a little.
What a noise that was from Jim.
Well, also just, ooh. You know, what a little a wrinkle we didn't anticipate.
Yeah. So we're going to get to that. But right now, Louisville has their new coach, it looks like, Purdue's Jeff Brohm, who just won the Big Ten West at Purdue. But I think we all agree maybe he started scraping the ceiling there. I don't know how, you know, is Purdue a place you're going to be able to compete for division titles and national championships on a year-in, year-out basis? I don't know. But he's going back home anyway. He's going back to Louisville, his alma mater, and they upgrade from Satterfield to Brohm, and it's one of the best things that happened to Louisville football in a while, and they didn't have to do anything. They don't owe anybody a buyout or nothing.
They failed upwards.
They failed upwards, yeah. That's
yeah,
exactly
I'd
right.
assume a lot of people are happy. Katie right now, though, has the breakup text. That is a
tough
look.
I think it seems supposed, but yes.
Supposedly, allegedly, Jeff Brohm broke up with the Purdue players by texting them, "Hello, guys. I just wanted to reach out and inform everyone that I have decided to accept the university."
Wait, how did
accept.
He spell
yep.
that?
He misspelled that's accept. To accept the University of Louisville head football coaching job. While I love Purdue dearly. Okay, well, you could have scratched that. Clearly you don't. The time is right for me to go back home. I just spoke to our football team at 1 p.m. today. I will personally reach out to each and every one of you in the next 48 hours to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you, Coach Jeff Brohm, Purdue. Don't have a problem with that. I thought that was
really?
Fine.
I think
he did also just say, I just spoke to our football team at 1 p.m.
That's what I'm confused about.
So
maybe it's like more staffers.
It must be somebody else, yeah. It might be the recruits.
That is a strange text if he did send it to the players, if he's already spoken to them. Here's the thing is that it and I know, you know, people are going to roll their eyes when they hear me say this, but we have the exact opposite as a social media that's gone viral or something viral on social media this past week. People gave Deion a ton of shit for how he handled things. Going in and speaking to your team, I feel like hits so much harder because we say this, and it's not just with coaching changes or job changes. You can't quit your job via text. You can, but it's frowned upon. You can't break up with somebody via text. If you're leaving an entire college football team, and if that was really all that he did, that's kind of shitty.
Well, time out. Have you ever been broken up with by text?
Yeah, and I hate it.
Katie, you ever been broken up with by text?
Kind of.
Jack?
Mm-hmm.
See, I'm from a generation that, I've never been.
Let's say you were.
I don't think texts were a thing the last time I got broken up with.
Okay, but let's say you were leaving Barstool to go somewhere else.
Oh, here's the thing. The day I leave Barstool to take my big money offer, I'll text the group. I won't text y'all individually. I'll text y'all and say, peace, bitches.
Would you text Dave or would you call him?
Oh, Dave would know, though.
Hmm?
I think Dave would already know during the.
Maybe. I guess, yeah, we're picking at straws here. However, you wouldn't text us. You would call us.
No, I would text y'all.
No, you would text us.
I would text y'all.
You would call me. You better.
Catch y'all on the flippity flip.
No, I think.
See ya, bitches.
Texting is so easy to do.
Holler.
And I understand there's hundreds of guys you probably have to text. But with the way that coaches have handled it, and we've seen coaches handle it, it's been the worst way. It's been like leaving notes. We've seen, we make fun of that. Texting is a lazy way. However, that text message doesn't make sense. If he's already spoken to the football team,
I think he did spoke, and it was at 1 p.m., and it was probably a meeting that not everyone could attend. So yeah. They have a group like message of sorts where they send it out to everyone. It's like, if you couldn't make it, I'm sorry, but I took the job. It's a brutal world out there in college football, but that, like, these,
I don't think 18 to 22 year olds are going to be hurt by this.
And also, like, your coach is leaving you, but guess what? That's how this world works. Like, you have to. I understand you're 18 to 22, but you have to mature.
So
I don't think that they're hurt by it. I just don't think that
if you left tomorrow, right? I'm not saying you would. I wouldn't be mad at you.
Well, here's what would happen. I would text Casey and say, hey, I got a better offer. I'm leaving. She would then call me and we'd talk for 2 hours. I would text Jack and say, I'm out. And you'd say, cool. Good working with you.
Yeah.
And then I would text Katie and say, hey, get your stuff. We're leaving.
Yeah.
She would do that, or she'd just be like, fuck
you.
No,
I'd be like, how much and where?
Don't let the door hit you on the way out. She'd finally say everything to you she really wants to say to you. No, I don't think that the players are hurt. But
he got sniped yesterday for doing stuff for me. I mean, doing stuff for him.
Yeah, I didn't. Whatever. This is not a big deal. Move on.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, I'll hear this story later.
Yep.
I don't. The players have to get over it. Some of the players probably didn't care. I just think that there's a reason that this is being talked about.
It was rumored for a while. Like, you saw it coming.
It's just like, just.
As soon as the Louisville job opened, everybody knew it was Jeff Brohm.
Yeah. And it's a great job for him to have, and I'm sure Louisville fans are very happy.
Now, Graham Mertz is on the move from Wisconsin to Kentucky. Kentucky, which just spent 2 years with an overrated, overhyped quarterback, decided to move on by going and getting Graham Mertz, the all-time original overrated, overhyped guy coming into college. Former five-star Graham Mertz headed to Kentucky. Now, new chance for him, new life, new everything, and I don't know. This is either going to work swimmingly, or they're just going to be atrocious in the first month of next season. I don't know which way it goes.
It's up in the air.
Because they're losing Chris Rodriguez. They're a good running back. That Kentucky program, they're in a be careful spot.
We've also seen, though, you know, players who are not working out elsewhere go to a different program, and that's all they needed. We've also seen it where it doesn't work out. Graham Mertz is just, I can't figure him out, because he's had that. I mean, obviously we made a big deal because of Dan, but like the Heisman talk.
For one game.
And he's had, but then he's had really bad games, and he's had games where he's just fine. But the problem is he's had either side of the spectrum.
It's a lot more bad games than
yes,
good games.
Definitely.
And the first game was against Illinois, and that was fool's gold. He never, I don't know that he's got three good games in his career.
Do you, like, good or just serviceable? That's the
I'd say good. I don't think he's had good.
I think he's had fine games, good games.
Well, I guess maybe
not Heisman winning games for sure. But that was the double edged sword of us, you know, naming him a Heisman candidate the way that we did.
We never did that. That was a joke.
I know, it's tongue in cheek. Okay, all right, good.
I just want to make sure that's out there.
In the same way, after Northwestern Nebraska, that first drive with Nebraska, we were like, okay, Casey Thompson Heisman.
I was convinced Casey Thompson was going to win the Heisman.
It was definitely a unanimously thing, but.
Remember that first drive, Nebraska and Northwestern, where Nebraska went right down the field, and you thought, "Oh my God, they're actually back."
It's also a product of the fact that we were missing college football so much, and that everybody had opinions. I bet if you go pull tweets from that game, there were a lot of people. I know.
Mertz just isn't very good.
Has he not had one good game ever?
He's had good games, but like he's not good. He's just, unless maybe an offensive change, but like. Going to Kentucky, how is that going to change anything?
Well, it's almost have a new offensive coordinator.
Unless
Kentucky is the Wisconsin of the SEC.
With Kentucky being gross,
but very good.
Their total for their bowl game is lower than Army Navy for this weekend.
Yeah, well, Levinson's going to play, and they're playing Iowa, so that makes sense.
I wouldn't have any quarterback.
Speaking of Army Navy, just really quickly, we will be there.
Yeah, we will.
Mm-hmm. College football show, 12:30. The
day before. Rough and Rowdy.
Yep.
Don't forget about Rough and Rowdy.
Grace is
should
fighting.
Be fun. Should be fun.
Jones.
Speaking of Wisconsin, Jim Leonhard has announced that he will no longer be with Wisconsin after the bowl game. There was a time where it looked like he might stay as a defensive coordinator. Now
he made an announcement too, I think.
Now one of the best defensive coordinators in the country is going to be a free agent. I'm sure he probably knows where he's going already.
What do you think happened with that? Do you think that this was a Jim Leonhard decision? Do you think that this was?
I think Jim Leonhard is a team guy and probably decided, you know what, I'm from Wisconsin. I'm a Wisconsin guy. This is where I made my hay. And then somebody said, you know what, we could actually pay you X amount of dollars if you come here. Oh, okay, cool. That's what I think.
And also, he got passed up. He had
got
his
passed
chance.
Up by Definitely. The, yeah.
And maybe but he'll get another chance
And Fickle
later.
Might have his own guy. Nobody says that. Fickle might have his own guy in mind.
That's why I was asking which one you think it is. Because if I was Jim Leonhard, and I understand he's a Wisconsin guy and everybody loves him, and when he was named the interim, they were hoping it would work out. If I'm him and they hire Luke Fickle, which is a fantastic hire, I still don't stay. I say, okay, I'm going to go elsewhere, make my way in back into the Wisconsin coaching job for the future. But the fact that he said he was going to stay and then he didn't, it was like, did he second guess it? Or did Luke Fickle say, hey, like I've got my guy, go out and see what you can get on the market. And clearly he's going to get great money on the market because he's one of the best coordinators.
I think the more interesting thing about Wisconsin right now is they just hired Phil Longo, the North Carolina offensive coordinator, as their offensive coordinator, which might signal an incredible shift at Wisconsin. For so long, we have thought Wisconsin is this. They're going to line up in the eye. They're going to have a fullback. They're going to have great offensive line. They're going to give it to a tailback who can run for 2,000 yards. And they're just going to run it. Phil Longo spreads the ball all over the field. He has these wide – at Ole Miss, he did it. At North Carolina, he's done it. Just good quarterbacks, wide open offense, ball flying all over. So maybe Fickle has decided in Wisconsin football, we're changing everything about it.
Phil Longo is the most defensive-looking offensive coach in the history of football, or the most strength-conditioning-looking coach.
He looks like he just got out of the military to come coach a team. Yeah,
and he's going to get in your face and say you're worthless and like da-da-da-da, but obviously he works. It works.
Yeah, I will say red zone defense needs a little bit, but
he does not look like an offensive.
There's also a tweet that came out from Braylon Allen earlier that said, "I'm going nowhere as long as Jim Leonhard is still here."
When did he say that?
I can find the tweet, but
today?
No, that
had to be months ago. Though.
Yeah,
that was okay, yeah, yeah.
Like,
he also tweeted LOL after they passed up on Leonhard.
I don't think you worry about Braylon Allen if you're like when you hire a new coach and a new offensive coordinator, like. You're going to need 40, 50 guys to run the system. One guy can't stop. Yeah.
I'm not saying that they're going to be like, oh, what does Braylon Allen want? But, like, could we see Braylon Allen enter the portal?
Probably. I would imagine so. And lastly, on the news before we get to my little topic here. Last night, Dylan Johnson, running back at Mississippi State, decided to enter the transfer portal, and his announcement was quite interesting. Did you see it?
Oh, I did see it. I was not only entertained by it, I was fascinated by it. It was a fascinating transfer announcement.
So he has the same graphic that they all have. You know, it's a beautiful graphic. He's wearing the uniform. I'm going to go to the beginning. First and foremost, I'd like to thank God for giving me the opportunity, yada, yada. Without him, I'm nothing. Got it. Family, friends, thank you.
Endless love.
Fans, support. Mississippi State University, my teammates, trainers, amazing fans. It's been an honor to participate. You guys have helped me build my character and skills tremendously. With that being said, and here's where it starts. Since I am not very tough and Leach is glad I'm leaving, I will be entering my name in the transfer portal with the hopes of finding a more fit playing environment for me. Thank you.
Thoughts?
I think the transfer portal is going to be an ongoing challenge for fans not to get emotional, not to get upset, to let these things play out and just accept that players can come and go as they please. And to realize that you cheer for the name on the front of the jersey and not the name on the back of the jersey. This guy busted his ass for three years at Mississippi State and was a very good running back for us, led us in rushing this year, liked him, enjoyed him. However, if your coach has said to you that you're not very tough and you respond to that criticism by not only entering the transfer portal immediately, but also by tattling on that coach and saying it to everybody, maybe your coach is right.
I would agree with that. Also, the fact that this is seemingly not a tongue-in-cheek, a funny thing.
Like this
that,
is not funny.
Not
no.
at all.
This is a very pointed criticism.
Somebody actually made him this graphic, too. Yeah. Like, at no point along the way did somebody say, hey, you know what, maybe you shouldn't tell on the coach like this, even if it's been said. Maybe we shouldn't put this in writing on a very fancy graphic. And the fact that it actually made it far enough to make it online is strange.
I just think, and he, again, good player, strong guy. I thank him for everything he did for Mississippi State. I think quietly entering the portal and holding this to yourself and letting it motivate you and then letting your play do the talking and embarrassing Mike Leach in the next 2 or 3 years by the way you play on the field is a lot more meaningful than the temporary embarrassment he levied at him last night.
And
because
also,
this announcement now puts kind of a bullseye on this guy's performance. If he goes somewhere, say he goes to South Carolina and he's a bust, well, it all goes back to this announcement.
And call me crazy as somebody who is – obviously not a Mississippi State fan or care what, you know, embarrasses Mike Leach or what doesn't. I didn't read this and say, oh, shit, Mike Leach shouldn't have done that. That was bad. I read this and was like, what is this kid doing? We know that with the transfer portal, coaches are telling guys the truth or they should be telling the truth behind closed doors. So if this is a conversation that they had, fine. I didn't look at this like it was a bad thing for Mike Leach at all. Do you think people looked at that and thought Mike Leach was an asshole?
I think a lot of fans of opposing teams did and used it to laugh at Mississippi State and Mike Leach. It doesn't bother me at all. I don't care if my coach is going telling players they're not tough enough.
Also, if you have 85 scholarship players, along the way, even if you have a great program, there's going to be some guys that don't like you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's even true of the greats. It doesn't really necessarily mean like maybe 3 to 4 guys don't like you or they don't like their position coach because they thought he was different. Or maybe this guy really isn't tough. There, it could be both ways. It doesn't really signal that Mike Leach isn't meant to be a head football coach. Obviously, we know that. But also, there's some guys that like may be great players, but they're just not meant to play for somebody like Mike Leach.
It's like the same incident as the Texas bus. The player, obviously, the player who like leaked the video is a higher level. Just like the football, like you don't, it's locker room talk. You just don't share it.
Yeah. Yeah, well, then we'll see what happens. Wish he was staying, but whatever. Next guy. I know Rodriguez Clark from Memphis entered the transfer portal today. He's had 2 good years in Memphis, and he's a running back from Starkville High School. So who knows if that's going to fix itself.
Yeah, the transfer portal stuff is going to be center.
The portal is going to be just the biggest challenge for fans. Like you just have to let them go, and you have to say, if they say something bad about your school on the way out, hey, good luck to you.
It's going to be the center of attention, good, bad, and ugly. And if they're going to throw shade at your school or your coach on the way out, there's going to be
who's
another
Tulu?
Guy.
Is that another guy?
It's going to.
No, he's our number one recruiter. He's Griffin, who's our kick returner, the best kick returner in the country. He's fine.
But why did he say, I feel you, brother?
He probably is just helping him out. If you look at all his tweets, he goes out and tries to recruit players for us. So
so he likes being at
Yeah.
I think at this point in college football, the only people who are truly loyal are fans.
That might be very true.
But we just talked to Max Duggan.
No, 100%. But this is like in
on the whole though, not in general. Yeah, on the whole, I think the
obviously there are always exceptions to that, but as a whole. There's always a bigger bag. There's always a better win.
There are loyal coaches. There are loyal players, but there's hardly any disloyal fans.
Well, and if there are disloyal fans, they're not true fans. But there's a fine line of what you describe as disloyal. Because like, if you, I also think that if you're a loyal fan, you tell the truth about your team. The issue with the transfer portal and the coaches leaving and NIL and all that is that it's going to force fans to realize that no one has to be loyal to their school.
It's a business,
right? You have that, that's what's going to be the problem.
The thing about being a fan is like I just couldn't imagine like being like a fan of say a team like Florida, and just being making that part of your identity and being a huge fan, and then maybe somebody online laughs at you and they have a Tennessee jersey on, and you just start acting like you're a Tennessee fan, saying Rocky Top just so you can appeal to them so they can like your stuff on Twitter.
No, I know.
That's just a random example.
That's just a random example. Yeah.
It's like when you pick a team from the Big Ten West and you pick a team from the SEC, then
I don't think she picked up.
She didn't.
I know I did picked up on that one.
Josh Bray?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
I'm talking about a former one.
Who are you talking about? Joey. I'm working on that. I just realized LSU and Purdue are playing in a bowl game today.
Flip Jersey, 50-50.
Yeah.
I hope both teams have fun.
Oh, I completely forgot about all that.
Yeah.
Well, he had a video that went viral. It's like the worst type of fan is like when you kind of root for this team and that team. Like, no, you pick one team and you stick with it.
Well, and there also is a difference, too, which we fall into a lot, which is where fans with their loyalty get like picky. Is like you can root for a school. You can be a fan of a school. We all have them sitting at this desk. And then you can also be on a side of something for either gambling reasons or opinions. But just because you gamble for that team or whatever, fans are not going to be able to accept that guys can just leave their uniform until the transfer portal is a very well-known.
If Drake May had left, I would be I would buy a jersey for whatever team he was on. I would be a UNC and I want in a Drake May Heisman.
Really? That's interesting. I would never follow a player.
I would never do that.
Okay.
That's interesting.
Yeah, no. I would for me is the NFL. Like I never cared about certain. I wouldn't go like be a huge Denver Broncos fan. But when Von Miller got drafted,
you want to see them do well.
But I wouldn't. I wouldn't be a Broncos fan. I think in college I wouldn't necessarily.
I know it's not like I go and like actively.
Like UConn
root
just
for
lost
them.
One of the best running backs. Like I don't care about him anymore.
Yeah.
I want him to do great as a human being, but like I won't
I don't
be
even
a Nate
care about that.
Yes,
well, I want him to be fine.
No, I hope failure finds everybody.
No. Nate Carter, I want you to have a great career wherever you go, but I don't care.
I hope your credit score is bad. I hope your significant others leave you. I hope your dogs develop diarrhea problems.
Bite your tongue every day.
I hope you bite your tongue every day. I hope your shoes become increasingly harder to tie or stay tied.
Every time you think the coffee's cold enough to drink, it's always too hot.
Yes.
You burn yourself.
Your taste
pizza.
Buds.
I hope you always, the first time you bite a pizza, you take off all the toppings accidentally, and now you just have a naked slice of pizza.
Yeah, just
bread. I hope that happens to you. If you leave Mississippi State.
You don't actually mean that.
Oh, I very much
no.
do. I hope every night you get up and go to pee, you stub your toe. And that's the worst one to wish on somebody.
And every time you go to a public bathroom.
No, when you
down,
you zip up after it gets
you get, like,
stuck.
There's piss all over the.
Ew.
All right.
I will say, I said all of that to say that I also am the one who not only created merch at this company, but also hit bonus merch for this company of a split Tampa Bay Buccaneers and New England
that
Patriots.
That was a very
niche, but it worked.
That
yes.
was like a example that will never happen again because it's like
it's Tom Brady. So
Tom
it's like,
Brady,
yeah, it's a novelty.
And he was like
Aaron
without
Rogers,
Tom Brady, this company isn't what it is.
Yes,
and then he
it's also
point.
The worst piece of merch in the history of this.
And
company.
But it would not. No, no, I thought
but
it was
at least
a good,
she's
I
putting
it was
out
good
merch.
Yeah, you. Yeah, I was about to say, did you have you hit merch bonuses
never.
Before?
I've okay. never.
Do you put out one of the last things you put out
did
merch?
Did you see? Y'all can both hush right now.
No, I know. I did. I love it.
Did you see it?
I love it. You showed it to me.
I got a new design.
By the way, Drake May is staying at UNC. There's
yes,
a lot of rumors.
Yes, he put out a tweet. I think when the Longo tweet came out that we saw he was going to Wisconsin, I screamed and then graciously said good luck to Big Cat. And then that tweet came out about an hour later. I don't know why he's staying.
Damn,
I like it.
When did
maybe
we get
he's
that?
Loyal.
He sent that to me
no,
yesterday.
He is,
we're going to put it in the store soon.
You didn't. Yeah. Show me it.
I showed her.
Can I see right, it? What are we cool. talking about?
But I will say he walked up to me this after it was.
Cartoon was so funny.
After it was designed.
I don't know if you saw it.
No.
Do you see this cartoon? Somebody at AL.com made.
Yeah.
And I just took captioned it makes you think.
Did this design in-house?
Trig did it.
Okay, fine.
And then I said, I like the helmet too. So he He also did one with just the helmet.
So what we're basically doing.
Drake listens to all our podcasts, by the way. While, he's a massive Georgia fan.
Trigg and I bonded. We're like, as long as Drake May doesn't go to Bama, we're okay.
And also, Trigg is so talented.
Oh, he's the,
so
the best.
Big very Georgia nice. Fan. He's such
very
a nice,
nice
guy.
Very talented. So what we're saying to Father. Everyone that's listening and or watching is that we have fire Unnecessary Roughness merch coming
new,
out.
New merch dropping soon.
And this time it's actually fire.
I liked the other stuff.
I did too.
We this one's better. Much like
a University of Richmond.
This one's better.
Yeah. No, this is
I
good.
Like my whore eagle.
I like whore eagle, yeah.
I just don't know what the... Okay.
It's a funny joke, but then you won't...
Not everyone's going to wear it. It's a problem.
It's just like, not everything has to be a hit. Maybe it doesn't work. Then we just make
At
the next
At least we're
one.
Trying.
Before you All get right. to your 7-up, 7-down, and your 2-be-carefuls, I don't know why you didn't do 7s across the board, we should talk about HelloFresh.
Jeez.
Yeah, she woman. Have to take a shot at me.
Bitch.
You know what we won't do? We won't take shots at HelloFresh because we love HelloFresh. And as we've mentioned, the holiday season is here. Thanksgiving was a little bit ago. Christmas, Hanukkah, whatever you celebrate is coming up. And one of the things that sucks afterwards is you're like, I know I need to start eating better. I know I need to start cooking meals at home, but I just don't want to go to the grocery store. I don't want to keep ordering in because it's so expensive. Better option for most? HelloFresh.
You've just almost...
I know I did. Shut up. Tis the season Tis the season for saving money wherever we can. HelloFresh is cheaper than grocery shopping, 25% less expensive than takeout. You can use those savings for holiday gifts or just to treat yourself.
You also don't want to go to the store right now because everybody's doing their holiday shopping and the grocery stores are full too as they're getting ready for their buying their shopping for that. You want to stay at home. This knocks out long lines. It knocks out waits. It knocks out all that. The box comes to you. Comes to you with freshly made ingredients, pre-packed, packaged, all that. You get a recipe card, you follow it, and you have a delicious meal in 30 minutes or less.
And you can choose up to 35 different recipes. That's what's so cool. They don't just send you whatever they think you want that week.
That's more than 34.
That is more. You can pick from your own menu every single week. It'll please everybody. You can do family-friendly, fit and wholesome, or even just simply veggie. You can customize by swapping proteins or sides. You can upgrade. You can add. Also, they have all these like little side bundle things that you can get. HelloFresh makes our lives easier. I've said it many times. It's one of the only sponsors that I actually pay for because I use it. I love it. Go to HelloFresh.com/Walker18 and use the code Walker18 for 18 free meals plus free shipping. That's a lot of free meals because you know why? Not only is it 18, also it comes with multiple serving sizes. So if it's just
big.
You, they are. If it's just you, maybe dinner, lunch, if it's a couple, whatever. Walker 18. Use the code Walker 18 for 18 meals plus free shipping. That is W-A-L-K. I can't even spell your name.
W-A-L-K-E-R.
1-8, the numbers, at HelloFresh.com/Walker18. Make sure you use both the URL and the code.
All right. Now, don't have that much time left, but we're going to nail it out right here. 7 up, 7 down.
Yes, sir.
7 teams that came out of the season with the arrow pointed upwards and 7 teams that came out of the season with the arrow pointed downwards. And 2 be-carefuls.
Okay.
What do you want first?
Is it good to start with the good or the bad first?
That's the age-old question.
Good news or bad news?
Here's my 7 up.
We
okay?
should do the bad because we're probably on it. We should start with the bad first.
Yeah, why don't you start with the bad?
What?
Why would you think you're on the bad?
I know. I
can
I've
go on for
that.
A bit.
I've accepted that for
okay,
a long
well,
time.
First of all,
I need to see who he hires OC.
You're on the good.
Really?
You're a 7-up. Yes, because first of all, here's my 7-up, okay? 7 teams seven. With the arrow pointed upwards. These are not numbered, but I'm going to say number 1, Florida State.
Yep.
No particular order.
Florida State has Jordan Travis coming back next year, and they go 9-3 this year, and they beat LSU, and they finished the season really strong. They beat Florida. They just started beating the piss out of teams late. They're going to beat the hell out of Oklahoma in a bowl game. They're going to be a 10-win season for them. They're going to be 10-3, and Norvell proved himself this year. Jordan Travis back next year. They are going to be loaded.
What percent shot do you give Jordan Travis of being in New York?
Next year?
Yep.
He's going to be one of the 4 or 5 favorites to start the season. I think. Caleb Williams, multiple guys.
Drake will probably be.
Drake, of course. Number 2, going straight, arrows pointed straight up, USC. Mm-hmm. Didn't end that well, but in one offseason, he produced a team that almost made the playoff. He produced a team that got to the Pac-12 championship game. This is a program that was down, down, down. And in one offseason, he surrounded Caleb Williams with enough talent to get this close to really having an incredible season. And one more offseason, Lincoln Riley's going to keep going that transfer portal. He's going to develop the guys he already has. USC, the arrow is pointed up.
And hopefully get better at tackling.
You need to work on your toughness. Number three, still in the Pac-12, the Washington Huskies.
Mm-hmm.
Michael Penix Jr. will be back next year.
Great decision by him, by the way.
10-2. He will be a top four or five Heisman candidate to begin the season next year. They throw the ball around the yard, and Kalen DeBoer can coach his ass off, apparently. They really turned it around. They were very good this year, and next year it only gets better for Washington. Washington is number three. Number four, still in the Pac-12, the Colorado Buffaloes. Now, hard not to go up when you were 1-11, and you've had four 10-loss seasons in the last 10 years. But that program changed the second Deion Sanders got off the plane. They're going to get transfer portal after transfer portal after transfer portal player. And that school, that team has changed for the better. Immediately, the arrow is pointed up for them.
Absolutely. And yep. There's a – I still say this, regardless of our connection with him or not, I cannot think of a day one hire in my lifetime, at least, for head coaching in college – that changed a program that quickly, at least the view of
day
it.
Day one? That might be right. I mean, yeah, like it took Saban a year. Yeah, okay.
Just day one, just like this program you know will be turned around and the hype around it being what it is. I can't think of a different example.
Number five, the University of North Carolina. Mm-hmm. They came into the season having to replace Sam Howell, having to replace everybody, thinking, oh, my goodness, I don't know what the season's going to be. NC State looked like they were going to be great. Wake Forest looked like they were going to be great. You thought in the ACC, you certainly didn't give North Carolina much of a chance to do much. Well, they got to the conference championship game with a freshman quarterback who has just announced he's coming back. Drake May, as long as he is there, they will have a chance to win the ACC. That's why I believe he's got him for two more years or one more year. He got him for at least one more year. Arrow's pointed up for North Carolina.
The issues that we saw the last 4 weeks – how do you not see that continuing? Where do you see the
– because I believe teams can get better and improve, and this was never supposed to be a very good North Carolina team. I think the defense will get better. I think the every snap Drake May takes is an investment in the future of North Carolina football.
I agree.
Don't.
Just take the compliment.
I'm thinking. I'm trying to process. Give me a second. I can't think as fast as you guys.
Yes, you can.
I'm not allowed to. I've heard Seth Luttrell will be. I would like that. I'm hearing like people are hitting the portal because of position coaches on the defensive side.
Do you think
you're
not allowed to think as fast as we are?
Not getting into this. I don't know. I believe, but also I'm going to circle back. I had closed off my emotions. I closed them off, and then you guys made me open them, and then we played Georgia Tech.
We didn't make you.
Yeah, you bullied me too.
I said that.
Making you enjoy your team's wins.
Yeah. And then we lost, and then we haven't won since.
But only one team is not disappointed at the end of the year. And if your team is playing,
I disagree.
No.
Oh no! One the winner.
Yeah. No, I disagree with that.
I think that if you, I mean, I can only speak for myself. Like if my team doesn't win the whole thing, I'm not happy.
I think.
I go 10-2, if I go 11-2 and win a Sugar Bowl, I'd be very happy.
But you have to lose. But you have to lose along the way. At least your team was like in the race for the conference.
All right. Number six. One state below them. South Carolina, the South Carolina Gamecocks. Halfway through the season, you didn't know, they didn't look great, but they finished by not only winning two big games against top 10 teams, they beat two hated teams. They beat Tennessee to ruin their season, who would be in the playoff right now if South Carolina didn't take them out, and they beat Clemson to ruin their season, who would potentially be in the playoff if they didn't take them out. And South Carolina beating Tennessee and Clemson back-to-back, going 8-4, Rattler's coming back next year, arrow pointed up.
And Spencer Rattler, too, having those two games – to finish the season and then obviously, you know, come back and have that confidence level because it was down bad at some point during the season. That's huge.
He should do the coin flip for the Orange Bowl.
And the teams who lost the South Carolina Bowl. And lastly, teams going up, and there are probably more. These are just the teams I wrote down. The Kansas State Wildcats. Before Bill Snyder got there, the Kansas State Wildcats were the worst program in America. They were an embarrassment. They had never done anything. And then Bill Snyder had that long run, and he did things. But after he left, you wonder, okay, do they go back to being irrelevant? Do they go back to that? Or do they find another coach that can keep them at a top level? Well, Chris Klieman in his third year just won the Big 12 championship. And they just beat TCU. And I think the way he's built that program, they're going to be good for years to come. I think Kansas State, the arrow is pointed up for them.
I like it.
Now, for every team that the arrow is pointed up, what goes up must go down. that doesn't quite work, but still.
What about Clemson with Cade Klubnik?
Yeah. Or they, let's see him do it again. Let's see him do it again. They just beat North Carolina, but let's see him do it again. That could potentially be yes.
And they're so used to being in the national title race that it's. Cool.
And then LSU maybe.
No. They were. I think they were kind of phony. They beat Alabama, and Alabama's just not as good as we thought. They got way too much credit for beating Alabama.
Well, and they also won a national title in 2019.
No, you're right. I just thought it was funny that you said it.
Yeah, they were made a top five team for beating Alabama, and Alabama's right. Not nearly as good as they were.
Utah.
Why are you doing this?
I'm trying to give more conversation. That literally the only thing I do is just try to add other talks. Not saying you missed them. Just thoughts.
Utah. I don't know. They're right where they were last year, I guess. It depends on how they finish the Rose Bowl. If they win the Rose Bowl this time, then yes, for sure. All right. Seven teams headed down. The Miami Hurricanes had a first-year head coach, but you got to be better than that. You can't be going out and losing to the teams they lost to. You can't be going out and getting embarrassed to Florida State 45-3. There was more talent on the field than that. I give a coach a pass in his first year, but – pass is gone as soon as they get back. If they go 6-6 or worse next year, they're in trouble.
Well, and not only do they have a first year head coach, which I understand, you know, sometimes it's not going to come to fruition, but they had a quarterback that I know both you and I, but not just you and I, across the country, people were excited about. Tyler Van Dyke going into the season was like, did you see the way he played in 2021? So to have the hype around a quarterback and still be as bad as you were, not great.
Second one going down, the Michigan State Spartans.
Ooh, Jackal like that.
Tuck coming to absolutely rob your school of money as he tanks your program.
I can't laugh at that.
Yes, no, yeah.
Well, your time's coming, and you know that. The Arkansas Razorbacks.
Ooh, spicy.
And I'll tell you why. Went 7-5, thought they were better than that. They were never better than that. They got to have a mediocre quarterback back next year. And they're about to get stuck with a coach who isn't very good. And Barry Odom, bye-bye. He's gone to UNLV. Briles is probably gone soon, too. Without those coordinators, the first 2 years, Sam Pittman never does a goddamn thing in Arkansas. And now when he leaves, you guys are going to be in a world of trouble. Arkansas headed down. The Texas A&M Aggies, number one recruiting class in the country, followed up by a remarkably shitty season where you go 5-7. You don't make a bowl. Every bit of momentum you had in the recruiting world last year is now gone, and you're just playing defense, trying to keep players, keep the team, keep the roster. You found your quarterback. That's good, but did you keep anybody else? That's the problem.
Keep it going. Keep it moving.
The Oklahoma Sooners.
Keep it moving.
You just watched Lincoln Riley and engineer a one-year transformation. Outside your conference. You just watched Sonny Dykes go to the playoff on the one-year transformation inside your conference, and you're still making excuses on a guy that went 6-6 with Oklahoma's talent against teams that you overwhelm with talent every single Saturday. You hired the wrong coach, and you're headed straight down. That is my take on Oklahoma. The Iowa State Cyclones. We keep waiting. Was Matt Campbell going to get this job? Matt Campbell going to get this job? At what point do we just realize Matt Campbell doesn't deserve any of these jobs?
You think they're going to go down more than they already are?
What is the arrow pointing up? It certainly isn't.
Well, no, it's not. But
where's the skill talent? They had a 107 catch receiver this year and couldn't move the ball. They had Xavier Hutchinson, who was great, could not move the ball. The quarterback they got, is he going to suddenly be good? The defense can only get worse. Matt Campbell, if you look, it's been a steady decline in the last 3 years.
Yeah, it has.
And we kind of act like he's a great coach because he once won some games at Iowa State. It doesn't work like that.
Didn't they finish 10th in the Big 12?
They were awful.
Yeah, they were terrible.
They went out sad. TCU made them look like a JV team.
So
obviously,
bad.
They're in the playoff, but TCU made them look awful.
Last three seasons, 9-3, 7-6, 4-8. That arrow is pointed directly down.
And in 2020, which was obviously a strange year for everything, no, obviously there, beating Oregon in the Fiesta Bowl, everyone was like, oh, Matt Campbell, he is gone.
Yep.
Is he going to be there forever?
He might be stuck. He might be stuck.
Looking at Indiana, too, with the COVID year.
Yeah, Indiana was one of the weirdest COVID years. They were so good that year and then just garbage. My last team headed down is the Northwestern Wildcats. We kind of said Pat Fitzgerald, he'll have a good year, bad year, good year, bad year. Well, just stack really bad years back to back. And where's the hope there? I don't know.
I don't know who Northwestern goes out and gets either.
And I have two be careful teams.
Before we go to be careful, you know what else is good.
The one you tried to talk about earlier?
BetterHelp!
Yes!
This show is sponsored by BetterHelp. Unfortunately, Brandon, most of life, if not all of life, does not come with a user manual.
Sure.
It just does not happen. So when it's not working for you, it's normal to feel stuck. But you know what? If you go to BetterHelp, they can help you figure that stuff out. They can help you figure out what's going on in your brain. Even if you don't suffer or struggle with any type of mental illness or mental health situations, just talking to people. If it's a career change or a new relationship or becoming a parent, therapists are trained to help you figure out the cause of those challenging emotions and learn productive coping skills. And Brandon?
Yes?
You need some coping skills. I need some coping skills.
I think my coping skills are fine.
Because you use BetterHelp.
Yes.
That is why. It's the world's largest therapy service. It has matched over 3 million people with professionally licensed and vetted therapists available 100% online. All you have to do is go on and fill out a brief questionnaire. They'll match you. If you don't like that therapist, if for some reason things aren't clicking, you can easily switch. There's no waiting room, no traffic, no endless searching. And if you don't want to have to sit in person, a lot of people don't want to do that. It's uncomfortable. You can text. You can call. There's video chats. Right now is a great time to check out BetterHelp again. It is okay to not be okay. You can learn more and save 10% off your first month at BetterHelp.com/Smith. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/Smith. I can't say this enough. Everybody needs somebody to talk to. So if you are used to having a therapist, but you want to try to change it up, BetterHelp can help you. If you're brand new, do not be scared. Go to BetterHelp, HELP.com/Smith.
All right, now, my two be careful teams, and then we'll get out of here. Tennessee. Just be careful, because it was a rocket ship ride up, but how's the landing going to be? Because Hendon Hooker's gone. You'll have maybe Joe Milton, maybe the freshman, Iama Vilea. Didn't get that right at all. And Maya Leva, we'll get it right eventually. You got Nico coming in as the freshman. But in between that, you'll probably lose Jalen Hyatt. You'll probably lose a lot of your Tillman, a lot of your offensive weapons. And your defense, not very good. So, Tennessee, it was fun. Just be careful of 6-6 next year. That's all I'm saying.
Michigan State 2.0?
Very high potential. Like, if there's a team this year that was really great and could fall way back to the pack next year, I would say this team. And maybe TCU, you watch out for them. That's fair, don't you think?
I shook my head. I think Tennessee does seem like they have a good.
Well, I think they have a good. Yeah, they have a good coach. They have a good coach.
Don't like Katie bringing up possibly Michigan State. Yeah, it's a possibility. I think TCU is probably a higher candidate.
Yeah,
but it's possible.
It is. It's easier in retrospect always to say, but I don't have the same feeling about Josh Heupel that I feel like people had about Mel Tucker when they handed him all that money last year.
Like, you kind of saw this year coming at the end of last year for Tennessee. Like, you kind of saw the pieces in the same way that when Nebraska was losing games really close, they kind of at the same point. Nebraska went south. Tennessee actually took that close and ran with it.
I have more faith in Josh Heupel keeping the wheels on the cart than I did Mel Tucker.
My last be careful team.
Can I guess it?
Yeah.
Is it in the Big Ten or the SEC?
It's in the Southeastern Conference.
Is it Alabama?
First of all, you looked, because that was supposed to be a bigger surprise than that. It's Alabama. Yeah, you definitely – God damn it, Casey. Anyway.
I didn't look.
Yeah, of course you looked.
As soon as you said SEC, I looked. I will say that.
Okay, it's Alabama. And that sounds crazy to say. Wild. And they're probably going to be fine. My God, they got the best coach in the history of the sport. They're one of the best dynasties we've ever seen. But they were built to peak this year. They were built to win a national title this year. They're going to lose Bryce Young, a Heisman Trophy caliber quarterback. They're going to lose Will Anderson. They're going to lose a lot of players on that defense. They still, unless they just go find in the transfer portal, I saw a big report from Alabama yesterday that Jermaine Burton's coming back at receiver for them. I'm like, oh, yeah, of course he is. He wasn't any good. they're losing Jahmyr Gibbs. Like, where is the skill talent we've gotten used to at Alabama? Like, if you're bringing in a new quarterback next year, new receivers, new running back, there's no guarantee they're going to be good. There's been a guarantee this entire dynasty, but now, off a 10-2 season where they lost to the only two teams worthy of beating them, just be careful.
What happened to Alabama reloads?
We saw it kind of fall apart this year.
1 year is enough to say that, though?
All I'm saying, be careful. I didn't say they're heading down. I'm just saying.
I'm pushing you. I'm pushing
you. You have a quarterback who won the Heisman and was back this year, and because the receivers were bad, because the running back weren't as good, the whole thing didn't work as well. Now you're losing that quarterback. You're losing your best player on defense.
And it's also, when you talk about they were built to be the best team this year, it's not just your opinion. Nick Saban said that. He said last year was a rebuilding year, and they made the national championship last year. So the fact that he came out and had that confident statement and had the offseason in front of the microphone that he did, it isn't crazy. I also just – I know we've thrown it out there. I'm interested to see what happens with Nick Saban in the transfer portal. Obviously, he can go out and get anybody he wants. He's Nick Saban. People want to play for Alabama. But it could easily, I think, Brandon, you said it. Couldn't it be a situation where Nick Saban just like, you know what? Fuck this. I don't feel like evolving to the next type of coaching line of duty I have to do, which is the transfer portal. Let's see if they can keep up, which I'm sure they will.
Yeah, I'm sure they will too. But just be careful.
Yeah, I think I'm completely on the side of that Alabama will be fine, especially if they find the right quarterback this offseason. That's the biggest issue, at least in my opinion, because – Ty Simpson, the guy that came in, has not been good at all. I've heard that he's just not adjusting well to college life. And then, on top of that, you have who?
Milroe.
We saw how bad he was.
Like, Milroe is like a much worse Jalen Hurts.
Yeah.
So you maybe have to go out and get somebody. But that being said, they'll have the most talented roster in the country next year. Or top two, top three.
Georgia exists.
Yeah. But
and Ohio State.
They'll be and they're bringing in the number one class this year. And he worked the transfer portal well last year. The guys he got didn't work out.
So he did.
Yes, but sometimes you make good signings that aren't good signings, if that makes sense. They were highly coveted players.
All right, I got to get out of here. It is time for me to go, but we'll be back. We'll record Sunday and release probably Sunday night as we keep going with three shows a week. Yes?
Yes.
All right. That is Unnecessary Roughness.